From the studios of Farm Journal Broadcast, this is U.S. Farm Report.
Welcome to U.S. Farm Report. I'm Tyne Morgan, and here's what we're working on for you over the next 60 minutes. As crop prices struggle, more farmers are willing to walk away from pricey cash rents.
Well, it's incredibly difficult to try and make those decisions.
We have his story, plus the latest findings from Pro Farmers' annual landowner survey. We have the scoop on why a popular music star is giving back. And in John's world,
government numbers, believe it or not.
U.S. Farm Report, brought to you by the dependable, long-lasting Chevy Silverado.
Now for the market-related news. The nation's feed yards are losing an average of $248 per head right now. That cut is $159 deeper than a month ago. The nation's feed yards saw sharp losses this week. According to our reporting partners at Drovers, the latest Sterling profit tracker showing those losses are as cash cattle prices dipping below $98 per hundredweight. That's the first time those prices fell below the $100 mark since December of 2010. Now, farrow to finish, pork producers also seeing losses at $45 per head. That compares to the $15 per head losses producers saw last month. Well, slower Chinese imports are pressuring pork prices across the globe. Rabobank thinks the pain isn't over, expecting further price reductions during the fourth quarter. The bank citing abundant supply and slaughter capacity constraints. Rabobank's Q4 outlook does point to pork prices slightly rebounding in China and an increase in seasonal demand entering the Chinese New Year. But as more countries export pork there, Rabobank warns there will be more players competing for China's business. Chinese officials said again this week the country plans to cut corn acres and raise soybean acres over the next 5 years. They say this will help them better meet demand. Also out of China, the country is halting its weekly state corn export sales until May. The National Corn Trade Center says it's to help encourage companies to buy the crop currently being harvested. Remember, China ended its state stockpiling program of corn this year, and the country says it still has more than 200 million metric tons of corn left to sell, but some analysts think those piles may be larger than advertised. India's imports of soy oil quadrupled in just the past 5 years. This is partially due to the fact soybean oil is a more attractive option, as a glut has made the oil more affordable compared to palm oil. John Payne says the relationship between soy and palm oil is also what's carrying soybean prices right now.
There's kind of a shortage in edible oils across the world. Malaysian palm oil has been really, really high of late, and that's really been pushed bean oil up. So in past years, you've seen the soybean meal lead the crush complex higher, but in this year, you're really seeing the oil lead.
Payne says the December soybean oil contract is up 6% since October 1st. The U.S. cotton crop took a beating during Hurricane Matthew. The latest crop progress report showing cotton conditions in North Carolina dropping 26 points in just 1 week. Now only 31% of the crop is rated good to excellent. Milk producers are still facing a glut of milk. USDA showing September milk production rising 2.3% from the year prior, and production per cow hit a record at 1,842 pounds. Kansas seeing the biggest increase in production with a 6.3% jump. Michigan is up 5.8%. All right, those are the headlines. Meteorologist Mike Hoffman joins us now with weather. Mike, we're seeing some harvest delays in the west from too much moisture, and some of our viewers are getting a little worried right now.
Thanks, Tyne. Well, as you're going to see on the weather maps, we still have some moisture, several storm systems coming in over the next week, week and a half onto the west coast. Still dry, and it's been expanding over the southeast, still dry over the northeast, and of course, central and southern California dry, although you folks are probably going to get some rain this week. But let's go back a month and see how things have gotten a little worse, gotten a little drier through the southern Mississippi Valley. It just seems like this area in the southeast didn't get any of the tropical moisture to the east, and earlier in the season, none of that tropical moisture to the west. So that's why you've remained so dry. So let's take a look at things as we head through this week. Storm system over the New England area, cold front down through the Appalachians as we start the week. There'll be some snow in eastern portions of Canada, mainly rain, though, in the northeastern portions of the United States. Warm and sunny in the southeast. cool and dry through the middle of the country. A couple of storm systems out west. These will be coming together to form one over the middle of the country by Wednesday. But in the meantime, that's going to be putting down some pretty good rain on Monday, Northern California into the Pacific Northwest. By Wednesday, then, that first storm system moving through Nebraska, or at least the north central portions of the Plain States. Rain with that system, showers and storms south of it. Another system off in the Pacific Northwest as well. And then the big one comes into the West Coast later on next week or into the following weekend, and that's what we'll be watching. Otherwise, generally dry, except in the Northeast, and you folks will be seeing that next storm system as well. We'll be back in our next half hour with a longer range forecast.
Thanks so much, Mike. Well, when we come back, grains and oil seeds seeing some life earlier this week. We'll find out what's causing the harvest rally. Tommy Grisafi and Mike North join me after the break.
U.S. Farm Report, brought to you by Mycogen Seeds. Visit acresofpossibility.com to discover the potential of Mycogen Seeds.
Welcome.
Hi.
Today we're going to be comparing the roll-formed, high-strength steel bed of the Chevy Silverado to the aluminum bed of this competitor's truck. Nice. You want to grab that empty toolbox for me? Let's start here with the aluminum bed.
That's a big hole.
Huge.
We got Swiss cheese for a truck here.
I'm curious to see if that will do the same thing with the Chevy.
Well, let's find out. Same spot, same angle, same empty toolbox.
Took it way better. The steel held up.
Silverado proved it is the toughest truck here.
You're driven. You refuse to settle. You're a farmer, and you are relentless. We're relentless too. So we promise to never stop, never settle, never ever back down from a challenge, because we know you won't.
We know who made that hitch. We know who cut the steel, who milled the ball, and who welded the seams. We know who tested, measured, and checked. We even know who thought the whole thing up. We're B&W, and we know your hitch. Because we don't make them halfway around the world. We make them all right here. B&W. Trusted.
Join Farm Journal for our annual Milk Business Conference on November 7th through the 9th in Las Vegas, Nevada. This two-day conference, led by respected and knowledgeable industry experts, is filled with timely information for dairy operators. Topics include the global dairy market, consumer communication, the big question about GMOs, and a panel discussion. For more information, visit milkbusiness.com/events.
Welcome back to U.S. Farm Report. On the roundtable with me this weekend, Mike North, Tommy Grisafi. All right, it's harvest time, so let's talk about that a little bit, starting off with this wide basis that we have right now. How does a producer manage that as we do see corn prices and soybean prices get some life here in this harvest?
I think to start off, the challenge with the basis is that you assume earlier in the year you're dealing with an average crop, and it's really hard to convince the farmer that they're or who could do it, who could predict we were going to have the bushels we're going to have in the areas we do. And so farmers in general, I was thinking, my clients, I don't know about yours, but they try to kill their crop two or three times a year. And so to tell them, hey, guess what, plan for having a big crop, lock in the basis, do this, do that, they don't realize until the bushels show up. Now the bushels are here, the basis is widening, and I don't think growers are happy about it, but it's a product of the record crop.
So what can you do? What tools can you use right now?
Really about the only tool you have in your arsenal is storage, because we're asking the buyer to drink from the fire hydrant when it comes to volume. And the reality is there's not enough storage in this country to handle a big carry-in plus a record crop plus record wheat inventories and just push all of this in the system. It can't happen. And so basis has gotten wide. The only way to really navigate that is with your own storage, so that as the buyer is back in a place where they can come back to the fountain for another drink, you'll have the bushels. And at that point, they'll usually be willing to pay.
And, you know, our viewers in the Western Corn Belt, they've had some harvest delays. I think, you know, in certain pockets, some of those farmers are getting pretty worried right now. So how do you manage those emotions when you're worried about getting this crop in? You know, you do see a little bit of a rally, but at the same time, we have this record crop on our hands. You know, what's your advice for that, Tommy?
Well, at this point of the year, usually a farmer has the least amount of money they have. Now, recently, they started selling soybeans off the combine and, you know, received an ARC payment. But it must be very emotional. I personally have never had $1 million worth of soybeans sitting in a field and couldn't harvest them. So they're very antsy to get to the crop. I mean, you can just support the guys. So one thing I can tell you is that the technology is there to, go get it. They can work around the clock. But if the fields are wet, there's still no super duper tractor that goes in the mud and gets it. So you just sit here and wait. And I think that's part of the reason soybeans have rallied is, although it's a record crop, it's coming in and a little more organized than now this corn crop's coming in the back and it's a little bit chaotic.
Why else are soybeans rallying? I mean, you know, you look at palm oil, and I know it's carrying soy oil right now, which is carrying soybeans higher. But at the same time, for soy oil to lead that instead of soybean meal, it's a little odd. So is that sustainable long term? Can soy oil continue to carry these soybean prices higher?
I don't think so. And the reality of it is we've also gotten a little drunk on the fact that the exports have been very strong. And that has to be the case this time of the year. We ordinarily will export nearly 2/3 of our bushels in the fall. And so when we look at all of these things stacking up on top of each other, Tyne, we've had a nice little cause for a rally. Funds have come back in. They've added to their position. So that has carried a little bit of water, too. But bottom line, no, the palm oil can't carry it forever, and we can only run it so far.
Do you think this harvest rally that we're experiencing right now, do you think it can last very long?
If it does, then we're going to look back at the show and say, we didn't realize there was something else going on. We didn't realize the market was nervous about the election. We didn't realize South America was having a weather problem. And so markets, they're futures markets. They get ahead of themselves. And I also think, Tyne, that the market was penalized for, you know, we had record soybean crop last year. The funds sold it. The farmers sold it. They sold ahead, and they were penalized for that. And so this year we had the most hated soybean rally in history. And it's just wild to see a farmer who committed to selling a crop at such a low price or having someone else manage the bushels for him. So I think the market has a little bit more. I think the farmer's selling slower this time in the soybeans for 2017.
We're seeing this rally, but at the same time, Mike, I know Advanced Trading called out the fact that corn prices today are still lower than we were a year ago. So let's look at the bigger picture right now. We are still trading lower than we were at this time in 2015.
Absolutely. And really, when you look at the big picture from a technical perspective, we really love the 3 to 450 range. Over the last decade, that's become a really comfortable zone for us. With spot markets hanging around 350, that's been kind of a secondary pivot point. I would say that, you know, if the rally is going to continue, you should look for resistance as we approach $4, $3.80, and some of those bigger numbers. The fact that we're lower is only a function of the added supply. Last year at this time, we were talking about a 1.7 billion bushel carryout. Today, we're talking about 2.3, 2.4. That's a lot of extra bushels that we need to work through the system, and record exports, record feed, and record ethanol are already built into the equation.
How many days has it been since the December corn contract is traded $5 or above?
I just happen to know that. It's been since May 13, 2014, and it's been 892 days since front month corn's been $5. Regardless of what you might have heard early in the spring or last year of $5, $6, $7 corn, we might have even had an $8 corn bull somewhere in the Twitter sphere. But the reality is it's been 892 days. So to my friend Mike's point, we have a lot of bushels in this 350 to 450 range, although the 450 parts only stays there about 5 days a year, and we're more comfortable with the 350 part. And so when we were down in Nashville, if we would have asked a farmer sell 360 corn, they would have laughed at us, and we were trading 440 down there that day at that conference. And so things change. Once the bushels show up, the perception and the reality and getting back to merchandising, not flat price speculation, the farmer starts to deal with the bushels.
All right, we've talked a lot about grains, but what about the livestock side of things? We're going to cover that when we come back from U.S. Farmer.
My soybeans are 100% Liberty Link. I started the Liberty Link approximately 6 years ago, going with the glyphosate system before that, and just noticing that I wasn't getting the control that I really wanted. Started in with the Liberty Link system, and it's been very satisfactory. Well, the velvet leaf is probably my most hated weed. I'll walk across a field 40 rods to pull a velvet leaf if I know it's there. And when I did spray, there were a lot of velvet leaf out here, and I have not found any. And I use a pre on the beans, and we can just come back and clean it up with our Liberty, and it does a good job. If you have a breakout of weeds, you know, you may be losing 20 to 30% as far as your production goes. Well, looking out across my bean field, I'm seeing that, you know, the weed control's been good.
The Liberty Link system, a simply better solution, now backed by the Liberty Weed Control Guarantee, because Liberty is simply better weed control by Bayer.
We're always up for a new challenge. We take pride in every project and every square foot. With Kubota's full lineup of subcompact and compact tractors, we tear down, build up, and create landscapes. We plant, grow, and harvest. We are Kubota. This is what we do.
There are no marks of conflict lining this landscape. No echoes of economic hardship. Just the unmistakable murmur of Mother Nature's hand. In the perennial quest to outperform, ensure your crop gets the nutrients it craves with Avail Phosphorus Fertilizer Enhancer. Nothing helps protect your investment more, so you can grow confidently no matter what comes your way. Avail. Hold your ground.
Welcome back. Well, before we move to livestock in China, officials announced that they're going to lower their corn acres and raise their soybean acres over the next 5 years. We've heard that before, but also saying they are going to halt sending out some of this corn in their stockpiles, saying that they want people to buy the current what's being harvested currently. Is it really that, Mike, or is it just this corn that's in stockpile, the quality is just so poor they can't get rid of it?
Chinese information always has to be read with a degree of scrutiny. And so the reality of it is there's probably truth somewhere in the middle of all of that. They remember are a growing country. Their middle class continues to grow. Their spending power continues to grow. That means they need more protein. That's why they're raising more soybeans. That's crucial for their growing hog industry and poultry operations. The reality is that they don't want to ultimately try to force their hand on corn when they have an opportunity to buy it at 10-year lows. Why? Pick up that inventory now. If the news develops later around your shrinking corn crop or a drought in the United States, then we have the inventory to fall back on, and this tighter corn inventory program that they're pursuing now gets balanced by what's going on in the world.
All right, switching gears to livestock. Cattle saw a decent end to the week, not a good day midweek, but a decent end to the week. What's moving cattle prices right now?
Well, at some point, Tyne, even big bear markets can't go much lower. And so incredible high amount of volume trade in the cattle between 100 and, remember how low they went, about 96, 97. I stopped looking at some point because it's depressing. And when you're working with people who grow commodities or raise commodities like cattle, it's hard to talk about prices like that. We are literally half the price we were a year ago year and a half ago in feeders. And so it's a challenging environment. The cattle industry is resetting. A lot of the wealth that was made in the cattle industry has been lost, and some guys have even lost more than that. It is very expensive to pay up for feeders in that bull market, try to sell them as fats, and then in a market that's declining. And so,
yeah, and the pork producers are facing a similar situation. Mm. I think Sterling Profit Tracker showed $45 per head losses last week. How do you manage that right now?
Well, hopefully you've had some hedges in place coming into this. We've, you know, gone to 41 cents. That, you know, it sets us up for a 1998 type of scenario. We don't ever want to go back that low, but the reality of it is we're up against big inventories. Beef, poultry, pork. The freezers are full. We're coming into the fourth quarter when they get fuller. And, you know, end of day, we just have to work through it. After low prices, you know, we see markets rebound, just like we are watching in cattle right now. Hogs are set up really to do the same thing, but we've got to get rid of some sows, just like in the beef side, we're getting rid of some cows.
And we've got a glut of dairy, too.
Lots of supply there. Cheese, butter, big, big inventories. We're coming into that time of the year where we depend on those to be drawn down, and we'll see how that stacks up. The dollar continues to get stronger, so export outlets become less of an option. This is going to be a challenge. Livestock all the way across the board is being squeezed right now.
Do you think we continue to see milk prices move lower?
Into the fourth quarter of this year and first half of next year, yes. I'm still hopeful of a rebound in the second half, but my optimism is declining by the month.
All right. Well, we're going to get their closing thoughts when we come back on U.S. Farm Report, so don't go anywhere.
We're all aware of catastrophic storms that can knock out power to millions. Powerful storms and high winds that bring down power lines. Even rolling blackouts caused by our nation's faltering electrical grid. So how can you protect your home and family from all these uncertainties? The answer is a home standby generator from Generac. It stands guard, ready to automatically supply power to your home within seconds of a power outage. For a free buyer's guide and DVD all about Generac home backup power, call 1-800-394-1563. You'll learn all about automatic home generators starting at just $18.99. Online at freegeneratorguide.com.
It's one of the best investments I've ever made in this house.
It gives you security, it's reliable.
That gives you that feeling of security that, to me, it's priceless.
Call now for a limited time bonus offer worth $495. That's 1-800-394-1563.
Introducing Smart Swab, another bright idea from Bulbhead. The new and innovative ear swab. You simply place it in your ear, twist, and remove your earwax. It's that easy. Typical cotton swabs can go too far and cause pain. Smart Swab's secret is the soft, spiral, grooved head designed to go the perfect distance into the ear. Then, with a simple twist, latches onto wax and safely extracts it without injuring your ear. And with our disposable, touch-free replacement tips, discarding is simple. When you call or log on now, you'll get a custom box of 16 Smart Swabs and handle for the low, low price of only $19.99. But wait, order right now and you can double the offer and get 32 Smart Swabs and two handles. Just pay a separate fee. But hold everything. If you order right now, we'll ship it to you for free. But you must call or go online now.
Call 1-800-210-1804 to get your Smart Swabs. Call now or go to smartswabs.com. So call 1-800-210-1804. Deluxe and refills available. Call now.
Welcome back to U.S. Farm Report. Time now to get some closing thoughts. Mike North, let's start with you.
Well, it's a busy time of the year. Everybody's rolling in the field, getting crop wherever they can, and the markets have been rallying. The key to this rally, I think, is to have a vision beyond what's coming out of the field. And as we look at 2017, there's some great opportunities out there to get very near to $4 corn on futures, $10 beans, and those are opportunities. Had we asked anybody coming into harvest if they could sell their grain coming out of the field for those prices, they would have jumped at it. Well, we have them out there for next year, and we need to start jumping at it. There's an opportunity in front of us. We need to be making some sales, getting some puts bought. Let's start strategizing for the year ahead.
All right, Tommy.
You know, to Mike's point, I'll just add on to that. You know, I talked to my friend Jason Winter, and he ran some charts on volatility and back month volatility option in December. 17 corn in November, 17 beans is at historical lows. And so the opportunity to put a floor in the market, we're not saying the market's going up, the market's going down, but you can't call your crop insurance guy right now for 2017 and put in a floor or get, you know, price protection, but the market is allowing you to do that. Do, you know, be respectful of the market. We were blessed with this huge crop, and I think with all the bushels coming in, you might realize that there's more bushels out there than we even imagined.
All right, thank you both. Stay with us. John Phipps joins us next.
Farmers will have an improved line of defense in 2017 against the most common corn diseases with new DeKalb Disease Shield corn products, says DeKalb brand manager Becca Waller.
It's an exciting new lineup that combines exclusive genetics with enhanced disease control. It's a strong defense mechanism against the top corn yield-robbing diseases that farmers are facing today. The diseases include anthracnose stalk rot, gray leaf spot, Goss's wilt, northern corn leaf blight, and in southern geographies, southern rust.
Waller says this innovation in corn breeding performed well in trial plots this season where there was significant disease pressure.
The Calve disease shield, really strong performance. You never know what's going to happen each and every year as inclement weather comes about. So we've not only seen strong roots and strong stalks, but enhanced plant health and, of course, harvestability.
Six DeKalb Disease Shield products will be available for 2017, she notes, ranging from 109 to 120-day relative maturities and be expanded the following year.
In 2018, we will be advancing earlier maturity products. And again, we're both selecting on performance as well as disease resistance.
Can Bosley regrow your hair?
This is my own growing hair that I can comb, cut, style, do whatever I want with.
The results I've achieved have been exceptional. This is my real hair. I can do with it whatever I want. This is mine.
Bosley gave me my hair back. I cut this hair. I wash this hair. I mess this hair up if I want to mess this hair up.
I can't explain to you the way that it made me feel to be able to wear my hair down, go out on a date, and have confidence again.
Can Bosley regrow your hair?
This is my hair. This is my hair.
Call or go online for your free, no-obligation self-evaluation kit. Plus, call in the next 6 minutes, and we'll even send you this $250 gift certificate. The information is free, so choose to grow back your own real hair. Choose Bosley. Call now.
It's time now for a heated topic in this week's John's World. For that, let's head to his farm. John?
The last several years, big government foes have had nothing good to say about just about any government agency. Angry cries to shut down entire departments like the Department of Education, for example, are a staple of political stump speeches. The justification is even mildly reasonable. Governments, like any group human activity, make mistakes. Laws are poorly written. Administration and clerical errors are inevitable. And citizens don't get the results they expect. From these experiences, though, we seem to have made a huge leap of illogic and have decided everything about government is bad, but especially government numbers. From unemployment figures, to inflation, to crop size, we now have almost half of Americans distrusting government efforts to measure what is happening in our economy or our population. It is even routine in agriculture. Farmers pepper their conversation with blithe accusations of nefarious tweaking of grain numbers or hog numbers. While this has always been the case, it could be more harmful than we think now. Loss of trust in government is no different than in business or personal affairs. Once every transaction seems liable for cheating or lies, an exhausting amount of effort must be made to guarantee against it, or a considerable sum must be spent to insure against bad deals. This creates enormous economic friction. The problem right now is, looking at farm budgets, we don't have much extra money to waste on distrust. Besides, I've always thought people who felt like the world was rigged not only revealed something about their own character, but were actually somewhat vain. The idea that government workers stay up at night inventing numbers to trick me certainly seems a little self-centered. My experience is, however, the world doesn't have to cheat to take advantage of me. Most of the people I deal with can do it by simply being better at their job than I am at mine.
Thanks, John. Well, still to come, land prices have seen a 25% decline from the highs a few years ago. But have we finally found a floor? That's our Farm Journal report after the break.
U.S. Farm Report is produced and distributed by Farm Journal Broadcast. From the studios of Farm Journal Broadcast, this is U.S. Farm Report.
Welcome back to U.S. Farm Report this weekend. We have much more ahead. It's a landslide, but have land prices bottomed out? Luke Bryan teams up with Bayer to give back, and you can chip in with a tweet. And in customer support, what if we eliminated CRP? Now for the headlines, a controversial rule that's been dormant for 6 years is getting new life. USDA says it's sending the final rule changes to the Grain Inspection Packers and Stockyards Act, or GIPSA, to the White House. And it's sparking strong opposition from major livestock groups. Now, the exact language of the final rule is unknown, expected to be released in the next few weeks. GIPSA was part of the 2008 Farm Bill, designed to implement provisions for buying and selling livestock and poultry. But livestock groups argue the 2010 proposal went well beyond Farm Bill mandates, costing the livestock industry money. The U.S. pork industry put in an annual $330 million price tag on the rule.
Not allowing packers to trade with each other on given days or given periods of time or have that ability, they would not be allowed. The way we contract hogs to a packer had some ramifications there.
But USDA argues the changes address some of these concerns. Regulatory costs are eating into farmers' outlooks. The latest Rural Main Street Index showing the lowest reading since April of 2009 at 31.8. That's based on a scale of 1 to 100. More than 1 in 4 bank CEOs think rising regulatory costs will be the biggest challenge. Creighton University also finding in their survey that 1 in 5 grain farmers expect negative cash flows this year. Regulation also the center of debate in Washington this week as the two leading presidential candidates prepared to square off in their final debate. Each of their camps discussed ag at the Farm Foundation Forum in Washington, D.C.
Regulations in and of themselves are not a bad thing. They level the playing field. They give certainty to businesses. They give certainty to our farmers and ranchers. And they build trust and confidence with the American public.
The fact is that we have a burdensome regulatory regime that imposes itself on, particularly on smaller enterprises. So it's not so much an anti-regulatory regime, it's the fact of the matter that when you write regulations or you impose regulations without symmetry, then you create situations that cause people to lose the comparative advantage that they have economically.
Now, both did agree the food and nutrition should not be separated from the ag portion of the next farm bill. Georgia's famed pecan industry took a major hit from Hurricane Matthew. Take a look at some of the devastation. Georgia's ag commissioner and State Farm Bureau president toured farm operations in three eastern counties. Ag commissioner Gary Black says pecans were one of the hardest hit commodities in the region, with many farmers losing up to a third of their operation. The Department of Ag says many of the trees are over 100 years old. And since it takes at least 7 years for a new tree to start producing again, the damage will have a long-term effect on pecan growers. Just heartbreaking. Well, that's it for the news. Meteorologist Mike Hoffman joins us now with a long-range look at weather. Mike, NOAA putting La Nina back in its outlook. Do you agree?
Thanks, Tyne. Well, even they'll admit it's just a chance of getting a weak La Nina, and I agree with that. It's going to either be not quite a La Nina or just barely one. We'll be looking at winters for that as we get our forecast out. You can see the big trough over the northeast, big trough over the west. As we start the week, as we head through the week then, you can see by the middle of the week, little ripples through the midsections. Otherwise, the troughs remain offshore. Another decent trough develops into the eastern Great Lakes and the northeast as we head into next weekend. But that trough off the west coast will continue to put in storm systems to the western portions of the country. Below normal temperatures over the next 30 days out west, the plains and most of the east expected to be above normal. 30-day outlook for precipitation above normal through the northern tier of states, as you can see, but that also extends down into the northern half of California and then below normal from Texas on through the southeastern portions of the country. Tyne?
Thanks, Mike. Well, our partners at LandOwner Newsletter say the decline in land values in the eastern Corn Belt is trailing the western Corn Belt by about a year. While their expectations are for the western Corn Belt land prices to not bottom until late 2017 or into 2018, the market is finding stabilization. In this Farm Journal report, we see how both the land and cash rent discussions are going to be a tough one in 2017. Farming this fertile Indiana ground is both Jason Wyckoff's passion and livelihood. But after 22 years, he was forced to make one of the most difficult decisions of his career.
We had been previously farming it on shares, and when this lease was up, the owner wanted to go to a cash rent, and we felt it was just in an area where we couldn't survive long term.
These 1,200 acres were a vital part of Wyckoff's business for 8 years. He added tile, irrigation, and made other improvements to make it a better farm.
And so walking away was a decision Wyckoff did not take lightly.
It's incredibly difficult to try and make those decisions.
And nearly a year later, it's one he doesn't regret.
If we were still farming that farm in the current situation, I would have a lot of anxiety.
Wyckoff isn't alone. In Pro Farmer's annual landowner survey, other farmers say if prices don't come down, they may walk away too.
Now, according to our survey, we find that 44% of our members and subscribers are willing to walk away from a cash lease if that lease is not lowered.
Based on these numbers, he says the cash rent conversations will be even tougher than last year.
And that was when we saw cash rents going down by 5 to 7, sometimes 10% in some areas.
Walston says another 5 to 8% reduction in 2017 cash rents seems reasonable. And when it comes to land values, those could also see a decline this year, but maybe not as steep as years past.
But here, too, we're seeing more people now looking for a reduction of less than 10% in 2017 than the prior year. Fewer people looking for a reduction greater than 10%.
And we would say the peak was probably in late 2013, early 2014 for farmland. And we're probably somewhere 20, 25% off of that number today.
Halderman says 2016 was an interesting year as farmer sentiments have been on a roller coaster ride the entire time.
I would argue that the worst time to sell a farm this year was March, April of 2016. That was when we saw the most negative attitudes.
That echoes the Ag Economy Barometer when producers' outlooks bottomed out at 85.
So what we saw was a decline into March, April, and then really maybe a blip up or some stability throughout even today.
We see that 30% of our audience are willing to step into the land market if the right deal comes along.
Halderman says just last week they had a sale in Rush County, Indiana, go for $11,000 an acre, and it was a farmer willing to pay such a high price.
We tend to see on most of our auctions still today, 75% of the buyers are what we term farmer buyers. So they are production owner operators that are actually out there doing the farming.
A handful of impressive sales combined with landowners' results in showing more farmers willing to buy indicates stability in the market, but prices are still searching for a floor.
I think if we continue to see 325 corn going into next year with not a lot of hope for some higher numbers than that, I think here in the Eastern Corn Belt, you could still see some land values under pressure.
But a flood of lender-forced sales is not hitting their business yet.
We've seen a few, but I wouldn't call it a large trend yet. Usually the ag lending season really starts to ramp up between now, harvest, and next spring's planting. And that's not to say, I would anticipate probably that first quarter of 17, if there are some concerns with ag lenders, they're gonna be talking to their customers and saying, maybe we need to correct something on the balance sheet and you need to sell something.
Whether to buy, sell, or walk away from a pricey cash rent, these are all difficult decisions farmers will face over the next year.
Rent decisions can be very emotional, and that led us to that process of, okay, how are we going to make these decisions? And once we try to take the emotion out of it, it actually then became very easy.
While Wyckoff hopes to hold on to every acre he farms today, it's some of those tough decisions that can help save farmers' bottom line. Halderman did tell me as fewer farmers come to the table to buy land, they are suggesting fewer land auctions and more private sales. Also, Pro Farmer members can view the complete landowner survey in the latest edition of Pro Farmer and Landowner Newsletter. Well, up next, John Phipps.
The CRP, good idea or not?
If your credit card debt is out of control, if you're in over your head in monthly payments, there's a secret the credit card companies don't want you to know. If you have more than $5,000 in credit card debt, you have the right to settle that debt for a fraction of what you owe. That's bad news for the credit card companies, but it's great news for you. We're Credit Associates, and we're offering you free information on how to virtually eliminate your credit card debt with a monthly payment you can afford. To see how much you could save, call now. 1-800-957-9636. Don't declare bankruptcy. Don't consolidate. Give us 10 minutes and we could save you thousands. After all, we depend on your success and offer a guarantee so there's no risk. Credit Associates. Live better, debt free. Find out how easy it is by calling now. for the secret the credit card companies don't want you to know? Call Credit Associates now and see how much money you could save for free. Call 1-800-957-9636.
We know you're up before the dawn because the cattle rise before the sun. And you spend long hours in the saddle because the herd isn't always over the next rise. And you care for the land because you know it takes care of your family. And we know you do great work. And it's time to tell that story to the marketplace. IMI Global is here to help you do just that.
Attention, female users of talcum powder. If you or a loved one were diagnosed with ovarian cancer and used talcum powder, you may be owed significant compensation. Medical studies have shown the regular use of talcum powder increases your risk of ovarian cancer. Call Guardian Legal Network to speak with an experienced lawyer now. If you don't win, you pay nothing. There are time deadlines to file a claim, so call now.
Call 800-818-4153.
There's a lot of focus on CRP acreage for next year, and CRP is the topic of this week's customer support. John?
Your call is very important to us. Please hold.
Terry Sizemore shares his thoughts on the Conservation Reserve Program, the CRP, and I quote him at some length here. Why should the government pay landowners any money, especially a level high enough to be a viable financial option to farming the land? If their farms are so unproductive that they can't be profitable in today's markets, they are likely incompetent farm managers and should exit the business and sell their land. I farm land that is highly erodible and is considered to be low productivity, although my yields have been much higher than the USDA-listed county average. My land is considered to be so bad it does not qualify for CRP. However, it has been profitable in today's grain prices. If we were to eliminate the CRP program, we would enable land to change hands and go to more capable managers and more profitable operations. Terry, thank you for writing and sending me an address and for presenting a position that I hear often from young farmers during any CRP discussion. The CRP will be more in the ag media if huge crops produce the burdens of surplus, as I expect. But I think you overlook its main purposes. The first is to pull fragile cropland out of production to reduce soil and nutrient loss. Another benefit is to restore non-crop land for ecological purposes. I will plant my first CRP acres of my entire career this fall as part of the pollinator program, for example. The CRP is not designed to be a safety net for inept farmers, but its structure may be serving as an attractive option for farmers near the end of their career to guard against falling cash rents. With our incredibly competitive land market, I can see how young farmers might see this differently. But I am concerned we are talking about land that should not, in my opinion, be in production in the first place. And more importantly, a significant regulatory invasion of landowner rights. The CRP program is not perfect, and there will be cases of bids too high and low being accepted. But it represents one of the few functioning efforts to deal with a major problem, soil stewardship failure in too many areas.
Thanks, John. And remember, if you have questions or comments, you can send those to John by email or Facebook or even Twitter. Up next, a popular country music star is giving back to local communities with the help of Bayer. We have the story next.
Can't get missed weeds off your mind? You need the powerful weed control of Liberty Herbicide. Now backed by the Liberty Weed Control Guarantee, the working non-selective that controls your weeds for outstanding yields. Take control of tough weeds and deliver real yields with Liberty Link Seed and Liberty Herbicide. Now backed by the Liberty Weed Control Guarantee. By Liberty, simply better weed control at your authorized retailer.
I am Jordy Nelson, Green Bay All-Pro wide receiver. My work on the field is much like my work on the farm. On both fields, I need teammates who give a consistent effort in order to succeed. That's why my farm and farm families all over America have teamed with family-owned quality liquid feeds. QLF's consistent quality and customer service helps farmers win every time. When you team with QLF for your beef, dairy, or crop needs, you are teaming with the best. QLF is proud to support American farmers that feed the world.
We've been planting channel seed for about 6 years now, gradually planting more every year.
Our channel seedsman spends a lot of time working with us, riding in the combine, walking our fields, and helps us find the product that works for our particular fields.
Our farm has unique soil types from sand, river bottom, clay, hills. So working with our seedsmen to know what products work where is very important to know we can maximize each acre.
Our yields have been extremely good, and that all comes back to our seedsmen knowing our land and recommending the corn that works for it.
We've had a really challenging year in some respects. We were very wet early, but channel has really come on strong through harvest.
We'll definitely be planting channel again next year based on the numbers we saw this year.
The products, the seedsmen, the relationships we've built together, it's really the whole package.
Luke Bryan is known as a country music superstar, topping the charts and selling millions of albums worldwide. Over the last couple of weeks, he took a break from his Kill the Lights tour and dedicated time to a special tour partnership with Bayer. He's focused on hunger and our nation's farmers on a 2016 farm tour. Betsy Gibbon was at one of the stops for an exclusive farm interview.
It's the heat of harvest for farmers around the country.
Harvest is going quite well. Got the soybeans are completed and working on corn.
But set back between these Indiana fields and back roads is an unusual sight for this Monroeville farm.
We've been here since 2 o'clock today.
Thousands of cars heading to the country, fans filling in the rows for country music singer Luke Bryan.
I'm a farmer's daughter, and I grew up every year watching my dad, you know, wonder if it's going to be a good year or a bad year, and you know, our livelihood depended on this. And so it's awesome that Luke gives back to the communities.
As these fans know, this tour is different. Bayer and Luke Bryan are teaming up to celebrate the American farmer.
What makes it truly unique is, you know, 2 days ago we were in a hay field, or we were in some sort of field, and now we have 30 tour buses and tractor trailers and stuff. So we're kind of like a circus.
We're about the American farmers, the hardest working people in America, and why not come out and celebrate them together?
The farm tour has two goals in mind: thanking farmers during harvest and providing meals for those in need. Bayer is donating one meal to Feeding America every time the hashtag ThankfulForAg is used on social media platforms, such as Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, and Instagram, now until November 30th.
Unfortunately, in America, we do have a problem, which is hunger. There are kids, there are families out there who don't know where the next meal is coming from. Our goal this year is 500,000 meals. Last year was 300. We nailed it. We nailed it early with Luke's help. Now we're going for 500.
It's not just a campaign for Luke Bryant, but part of his history. Agriculture runs deep in his family. His dad is a peanut grower down in Georgia.
I would spend my afternoons working at the peanut mill, and you know, I'd have to go out to the fields and pull the peanuts in on trailers and get them on, get moistures on them and get them dried and get them ready to go to the shelling plants.
Knowing if he wasn't singing on stage, farming would likely be his future.
At any moment in my life, I could have took a different path or a different direction and still be working in ag.
Instead, he's here, giving thanks during harvest, helping feed those in need during a few nights of fun.
Anytime we can bring a little more awareness to farmers and uplift them and encourage them and let them know that people are thinking about them, and certainly guys like myself are trying to do what I can to prop farmers up and spread the word out there. It feels like something that I'm destined to do, and I enjoy doing it.
Reporting in Monroeville, Indiana, I'm Betsy Gibbon.
So don't forget to use that hashtag ThankfulForAg to help feed someone in need. When we come back, Machinery Pete has this week's classic tractor.
Introducing the all-new DR Leaf and Lawn Vacuum, now at our lowest price ever. The DR cleans up acres of leaves and grass while you mow. In the spring, collect dead grass, wet leaves, and twigs from storm damage. Come summer, the DR makes a great high-capacity bagger. And in the fall, turn days of raking into a drive in the park. When it's time to unload, nothing could be easier. Look, just one hand. Plus, with the collector top removed, you've got a rugged utility cart that's great for all kinds of hauling chores. The DR is the most powerful, most versatile lawn machine you can buy.
Call 1-800-718-7570 for your free buyer's guide and DVD. Learn how you can try a DR at home for a full year. Payments start as low as $37 a month, and free shipping is now in effect. That's 1-800-718-7570. Online at drleafvac.com.
Attention homeowners. Quicken Loans has some very important information regarding the U.S. government's Home Affordable Refinance Program, or HARP. Nearly 3 million homeowners have already taken advantage of this fantastic money-saving program. But there are so many more of you who could be saving hundreds of dollars every month on your mortgage. Quicken Loans is here to help you save money. Why Quicken Loans? The home loan experts at Quicken Loans fully understand the HARP guidelines. We'll work with you to understand your specific circumstances and strive to find the financial solution that's best for you. Then we'll guide you through each step of the mortgage refinance process to make sure that it's both simple and easy. If you weren't HARP eligible in the past, new guidelines could mean that now you are. Give us a call and we'll give you a Quicken Loans mortgage review. It's simple and easy. To learn more about this money-saving U.S. government program, call Quicken Loans today or go to quickenloans.com for a mortgage experience that's engineered to amaze.
Time now for Tractor Tales with Machinery Pete, the most trusted name in farm equipment.
Welcome back to Tractor Tales, folks. We have a 1941 Alice Chalmers C to share with you today, and we're heading off to Southeast Ohio. While this classic iron may be retired from field work, owner Pat and his dad enjoyed restoring it to its original luster. Identical to one his grandfather owned, this C brought back some great memories.
I got a 1941 Alice Chalmers C. It was restored by my father. He acquired it from a fellow in Collinsville. His dad grew up on a Alice Chalmers C and did a lot of custom work for people when he bought his. It was one of the first ones in the area. And Dad grew up on a C and he wanted one, and I went with him. We bought it and he redone it. We just showed it around different shows throughout Ohio and some in West Virginia. Oh, they like it. They say it's a pretty sharp tractor, and a lot of people growed up on the Alice Chalmers. It was a pretty popular tractor back then in the day. He hasn't drove it for quite some time, but he used to take it out on drives whenever he first done it. And I took it on a tractor ride a couple years ago. We have a tractor ride each year, and I took it on a tractor ride. It was really enjoyable. So one of the original seat. Dad had the seat redone and put new rims and tires on it and new hood and a lot of sanding and preparation cleaning. You know, my grandfather grew up on a Alice Chalmers, and it was a big tractor back then. I mean, and you know, he did a lot of custom work for some of the neighbors. You know, they did. It was back when the horses were just kind of fading out and tractors was coming in. So it was a big improvement for agriculture back then.
Thanks so much for that. Well, today's Country Church Salute goes to the Old Dutch Church in Sleepy Hollow, New York. This historic church is a 17th century stone church sitting happily on 5 acres in New York State. Now, the church was actually featured in Washington Irving's The Legend of Sleepy Hollow. Thanks for sending that in. And if you have a church that you would like to submit, you could do that to the address on the screen. Stay with us. From the Farm photos are next.
How's it going?
Hi.
Today we're going to be comparing the roll-formed, high-strength steel bed of the Chevy Silverado to the aluminum bed of this competitor's truck.
Awesome.
All right, let it drop. Let's see how the aluminum bed of this truck held up.
Wow.
That's a good-sized punch here.
That's all the way through, for sure.
Full-on crack here.
You're aluminum now, you're going to go, ugh.
Let's check out the Silverado steel bed.
Wow.
Yeah, a couple dents.
I'd expect more dents.
Chevy clearly held up better than the Ford.
Find your next piece of machinery with the most trusted name in farm equipment. MachineryPete.com has more than 100,000 pieces of machinery listed for sale, from thousands of dealers across the country. It's the fastest site to find and value your next piece of used equipment. Shop with the most trusted name in farm equipment at MachineryPete.com.
Are you paying too much for your cable or satellite TV? The U.S. government passed a bill mandating free over-the-air digital transmission of all broadcast network television channels. That means with the new TV Freeway digital antenna, you can get free HD programming from your favorite broadcast networks 24/7 without a bill. You just plug it into the back of your TV and start watching all of your favorite broadcast programs for free. There are no contracts to sign, no hidden fees, and no monthly fees. Just free HD broadcast TV. Take it with you anywhere. Call or go online now to get your TV Freeway stick for the incredibly low price of only $14.99. But wait, call or click now and you can get a second TV Freeway stick for a second TV. Just pay a separate fee, but you have to order right now.
Call 1-800-316-1198 to get your TV Freeway. Call now or go to tvfreeway.com. So call 1-800-316-1198. Call now.
Welcome back. Well, Mike, our friends in Texas, they started harvesting cotton. Check out this side-by-side that Jeremy sent us from the Stanton area. He says this is the difference 5 months can make. Jeremy sent us the flooded photo back in May, Mike, when they had some torrential rains. But now it's a blanket of white with harvest in full swing. USDA says 22% of the state's cotton crop is harvested, 2 points behind average.
And in New York, viewer Tim Murphy has soybean harvest. He says it's going well. He's located about 90 miles north of Manhattan. They suffered from a severe drought this year, though.
Yeah.
Dry weather gripped much of the Northeast all summer, although it's been raining this weekend.
Well, the hashtag cab corn craze, it continues. Mark says, what do you do with all the excess cab corn? Well, Cowboy Logic says, turn the cows in. It looks like he's reliving most of our childhood doing some carpet farming.
And to end on a fun note, can you believe it's been 50 years since It's a Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown?
No.
Made its debut?
Seriously?
Yeah. Now the Halloween special is getting some love at corn mazes across the country. To honor this milestone, farmers across the country have featured Peanuts-themed corn mazes this season. A company called The Maze Incorporated specializes in corn maze designs. It'll map out and cut the corn. They say they did 90 farms this season, all to honor a classic cartoon. I would have been 8 when that started, so I probably saw the first year.
That dates
you. The right.
Well, if you have any pictures you would like to send, you can do that to the address or to Facebook or Twitter. For all of us at U.S. Farm Report, thank you so much for watching. I'm Ty Morgan. Be sure to join us again right here again next week as we work to build on our tradition. Have a great weekend, everyone.
High-strength steel for high-strength dependability. Chevy Silverado, the official news gathering vehicle of U.S. Farm Report. U.S. Farm Report is produced and distributed by Farm Journal Broadcast.